is the Kingdom of God and Christ. Today we're going to be looking at just a tidbit of information and just kind of review what we looked at and so we know where we're going from here. So we've understood now that the first century church, second century church, up to the Council of Nicaea, which is at 325, there is no homoousios used in Christian doctrine. It existed, and there were church leaders that taught about how homoousios was being used in other faiths, like Gnostic faith and Gnostic Christians being using homoousios, but not for the mainstream church. And so we know that for the first century, the second century, and the third century, there is no homoousios in existence in the Christian understanding. So there is no three-in-one doctrine. There is no two-in-one doctrine. So there is no there's no binitarianism. There is no concept of that in the early church. So this is just a timeline for you guys to be able to see where we're, hopefully you guys can see that, where we're looking at here. This is obviously kind of where Jesus might have been born, a little before zero, maybe a little, maybe not, dying around 30 AD or 33 AD, depending on who you ask. But it's generally in this area here. Conversion of Paul, obviously, you have the Jerusalem Council, Barnabas and Paul's stuff, Hermes, Ignatius, Polycarp. These are the early church fathers that we're looking at here. Hermes, Ignatius, Polycarp. You have Clement of Rome here. You see Justin Martyr, a little after the first century. Then we got, let's see here, Irenaeus, Barnabas' epistle, Tertullian, Clement of Alexandria, Justin's apology, Gnosticism and Monotism, or Rise. You got Celsus, you got Origen, maybe, Hippoplytus. You can see these guys. All of these early church, all of these early church fathers. There's Eusebius. None of these guys, up to this point right here, none of these guys have homoousios in their doctrine, and they are no three-in-one. There's no consubstantial idea. You have Nicaea in this area here. And you have the Edict of Milan, which is where the church kind of comes to, where the church is accepted. You have the Council of Nicaea here. And you see kind of the Arian controversy and reactions. Supposedly, if you look how close these are, the Edict of Milan, and then you see the Arian controversy. In actuality, what happened was the church got accepted and was no longer being persecuted. And then after they came out of hiding and became together and were able to meet and everything, some of the leadership had arguments or had problems with, namely Alexander of Alexandria had a problem with Arius telling him that he was changing his doctrine. And that's where the Arian controversy started coming along. Then the Council of Nicaea later on by Alexander of Alexandria against Arius started to begin. But until this point right here, no homoousios. So all of these church fathers, Origen, Eusebius, Hippoplytus, Justin, Barnabas, Clement of Rome, Polycarp, Hermes, Ignatius, all of these leaders of the church, they have no, zero doctrine of consubstantial, co-eternal, three-in-one, anything. So we have to understand that. And I showed you where in the book Divine Substance, the guy studied homoousios, and it just doesn't exist in the church until 325. Justin Martyr. We're going to start with Justin Martyr just to give you a tidbit of information and understanding about how Arian somebody can be. He is pretty explicit in his understanding. And Justin Martyr is not rejected by the church. Everyone respects him. Everyone has him as a leader and an apologist for the church. There's no problem with him in the church. They accept him. And you can pause the video if you want to read about Justin. A couple of places where he writes. First, we're going to go to the First Apology, chapter 13, page 167 in the Antonicene Fathers, volume 1. It says, our teacher is Jesus Christ, and we reasonably worship him, having learned that he is the Son of the true God himself, and holding that him in second place and the prophetic spirit in the third. So what I'm trying to show you with this is that it's amazing how people have tried to say that the early church fathers are not hard to understand, or that they preach the doctrine of Trinitarianism so well, and then on the other, you know, and on the other hand, there are scholars who are saying that there's no homoousios doctrine anywheres in the church until 325. So what's the deal? There, for all honesty, anyone who says that that Justin Martyr is a Trinitarian is a liar. I'm just going to say it like that because it's true. Justin Martyr is not a Trinitarian. Far from it. And look at the what he said, the Son of the true God himself. Did Justin say that Jesus was the Son, was the true God himself? No, he said he's Son of the true God. And so you can see the difference. The true God, the only true God, like Jesus said, like Arians today believe, who we don't even want to be called Arians, but the Arian theology says the Son is born as a God because he's the Son of God, but he is not the only true God. There's only one true God, and that's the Father. He is Son of the true God. And that's kind of the trick that they like to say. Well, if God's the true God, then what kind of God is Jesus if he's not God? This is the answer right here. He is the Son of the true God himself. He is Son of the true God. And then he calls Jesus in the second place. We'll eventually get there, but there's a place where people are complaining about Eusebius and even Origen and saying that they're Arian. And one of the reasons why they say that, look, he's obviously Arian because he says that Jesus is in the second place. And anyone who says that Jesus is in the second place is an Arian, essentially, is the argument. And so Justin Martyr, according to this is during the time of the Council of Nicaea, they said this. If you're to apply that same standard to Justin Martyr, you would have to say that Justin Martyr was an Arian as well. So I'm just saying, be consistent if you're going to be consistent, right? If you're going to say something. So that's Arianism. That's not Trinitarianism in any way, shape, or form. Then we have Justin the Second Apology, chapter 13. He says, next to God, wow, that means he's not God. He's saying, next to God, we worship and love the Word, who we know is Jesus. And so for those of you guys who don't believe that the Word is Jesus, the early church has always, from the beginning, believed that Jesus is the Word. They understood John's gospel to say that that the Word is Christ. And you guys who want to deny that are not consistent with the early theology of the church. So next to God, not that he is God, but next to God, because God is only one, we worship and love the Word, who is from the unbegotten God, the unbegotten and ineffable God. Let me tell you something about Arians. And the way, and Trinitarians say that Jesus and the Father are uncreated, both of them, that Jesus never came into existence. That's essentially part of their argument. And if you're going to not be Trinitarian, how would you make a difference between the two? Well, you would call one the unbegotten and the other one begotten. Arius said that Jesus was a begotten God. Justin is saying that the unbegotten Father, that the unbegotten God, is a different person. I mean, he's identifying. I'm not talking about the begotten God. I'm talking about the unbegotten God. You have to understand that in the early church, this is how they differentiated between the two. After the Council of Nicaea, they tried to stop doing that, differentiating between calling one unbegotten and the other unbegotten. Because if they're one and the same, why even point it out? But because they're Arian, they're pointing it out because one is the true God, which is the unbegotten one, and the other one is the born God because he's the son of the true God. Things you need to understand when you read the early church fathers. When you point out unbegotten, you're pointing out a difference between the two. And you're showing the substance is different, that you're showing that this is a different person. And so this is something that happens throughout the early church fathers, where they keep reminding you, I'm talking about the unbegotten God here, I'm talking about the begotten. It's very, very, very clear when they say, when they raise up unbegotten, it means we're not talking about the Father and the Son. We're talking about only the unbegotten, because Jesus is the begotten God, according to John chapter 1, verse 18, which we've already covered in the video Monogenes. It's explicit. So let's go to this next one. I shall attempt to persuade you that there is said to be another God and Lord, subject to the maker of all things. So he's saying, you know, I'm going to prove to you. This is Justin talking. I shall attempt to persuade you, he says, that there is said to be another God and Lord. Another means not the same one, not one and the same, not Trinity, not any of that stuff, not homoousios, which we obviously know doesn't exist until, whatever, 200 years later or whatever. So this is not subordinationism. This is not binitarianism. This is Arianism at its clearest and most rawest form. So what? How can you say that Arianism didn't exist before Arius? It's obvious. This is obvious here. And this happens throughout all of the early church fathers, patristics. Before Nicaea, where they want to twist the words of these men and say that they believe Trinitarianism, but hermeneutically, when you want to look into the time period and who's speaking and all of that stuff, the one thing that the Trinitarian scholars want to forget is that homoousios isn't even part of the doctrine. They want to pretend like it's still part of the doctrine. Oh, they didn't have it. They didn't have the words to explain it, blah, blah, blah. But that's not truth. That's not fact. The words existed. They existed prior to the church. They were used by Gnostic Christians. So what does that mean? Trinitarianism is a Gnostic from Gnosticism. That's from Gnosticism, not Arianism. Arianism is the original Orthodox faith. It should not be called Arianism. It should be called Christianity. And whatever this other faith is that was introduced by Alexander of Alexandria and championed by Athanasius should be called Alexandrianism. That's what it is. Not Trinitarianism. Not Catholicism. It's Alexandrianism. Because it's who he is who brought this in. And that's who it should be named after. So, whoever wants to believe Alexandrianism, that's your choice. But what I need you to understand is that the early church believed what Arius believed. And that's why he learned it from others. He didn't develop it himself. So we'll move on in the next video and start digging a little deeper. That was just a little teaser. But we'll get into it for sure. So be ready. We're going to get into it pretty deep and see what's out there as far as truth is concerned, as far as Arianism, which shouldn't be called Arianism anymore, and the lie of Alexandrianism. So, until then.